How are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm doing well. I've asked every driver this, and I know that you have a little one at home still with Oakley and your wife, Haley. What's quarantine been like for the Dillons?
Oh, it's been really good. We've enjoyed it. You know, for our whole time together, we've always been traveling and going. So for us to actually get some slow down and get some normal routine has been really awesome. You know, I think for everybody, it's not really easy being, you know, stuck at home, but, we've been able to find some silver linings in it and being able to watch Oakley grow up. It's been really fun for Haley and I. So it's, in good, there has been some good, I guess, silver linings to it for us.
Absolutely. Now you're a girl dad, you have one at home with Oakley, and you share her on social media a lot, but all of the dads that I've talked to that are drivers talk about how much their child can change. You know, they'll leave for a weekend and they come back and it's like it's, you know, a different kid. So how fun has it been just to be there with Oakley? And I know she's enjoyed having dad at home.
Yeah, it's been so much fun. And just Haley and I, sometimes we'll get a night away for a couple hours and come back and be like, wow, she seems even bigger
who
than
is
Ben.
This kid? Yeah.
Yeah, it's so cool. And to be able to spend that consistent time, you know, a lot of people, our job is we're moving and going all the time, and just being able to have consistent time in the same place with her and watching her grow that way has been super fun. And I know we're all excited to get back to the racetrack, but it's been cool to be able to just really dive into watching her grow with Haley.
Yeah, Oakley is very entertaining. She puts on shows. If you guys haven't seen it on his social media yet, she's really cute.
Yeah.
Okay,
so, we like her. We're gonna keep her.
Yeah. After what is it? 3 years now of the trial run. I think you're set.
Yeah. She's about 2.5.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So before we get into Darlington and going back racing at Darlington and Charlotte in the next couple of weeks, I want to ask you about the Pro Invitational Series, because you're a big advocate of iRacing. Your rig is what, 10 years old? So we know that you've been doing it for a long time. And how cool was that for you guys to step into that sim rig on iRacing and put on a show on Sundays for fans?
Yeah, so like you said, I have the same rig that I had about 10 years ago, and I actually didn't run iRacing. I ran a different game back when I raced ARCA, and it's the same rig, and I really hadn't raced on it in about 9 years. So those were my first iRaces, but I've always, you know, for a long time have connected myself to online racing and sim racing. And so it was a lot of fun to, I think most importantly, just do something for the fans during a time that's been so uncertain for everybody, and just needing you know, a glimmer of fun and a little bit of a distraction to get off what the world's been going through. And I'm glad that we were able to provide some fun entertainment, and it really grew to something bigger than I think anybody expected. And so it was a great win, I think, for our sport and for our fans, and for us drivers too. I think on behalf of myself and all the drivers, just to get together and make it happen was a huge, huge deal. So really proud of everybody, NASCAR and iRacing and my fellow drivers, for putting it together for our great fans.
Yeah, it was very impressive how everybody came together. But I have to say, the coolest part for us fans here at home was we actually got kind of inside of your guys' helmet to see what it's like with you racing. You were one of the most intense. Your face did not move the whole time. Are you like that in a real race car where you were just stone cold?
Yeah, definitely. When I was growing up racing on dirt, I would always get felt like sandpaper in my eyes because I would never blink. So I would just be so stone cold focused. My eyes would be so dry, and I'd finally blink after the race, and it'd be like sandpaper going across them. And I think it's just something I've adapted. It's my mind. I'm kind of a short attention span outside the car, but I think there's enough going on for me. It helps me hyper focus inside the car. So yeah, I have a pretty stoic, straight face inside the car, I think, normally, too.
They would show you, and I'd be like, man, Ty is mad at somebody, but your racing face.
Yeah, for sure. That's the good thing I get to wear a helmet during the race.
Yeah, I think a lot of you are ready to put those helmets back on. Speaking of which, we're going racing Sunday. Darlington is the end in sight. We're finally back in those race cars, and it's going to be no practice, no qualifying. You unload on the truck, and the green flag is dropping around 3 p.m. So what's that going to be like for you guys, hopping back in the car, not knowing what to expect?
Yeah, I you know, I think it's kind of fun. Anytime you have a unique circumstance, I always see it as opportunity. And for our team, when we're a little bit undermanned and underfunded compared to the bigger teams, we really take these as opportunities to go out and excel and do our best job. We have a great sponsor who has provided so much for us over the years, and our promise to them is that we would continue to grow each year. And I think we're starting to really do that in year four. Last year was a solid year of growth for us, and we started off this year pretty much on a really good track and heading in the right direction where we want to be, and for our sponsors and So I'm excited to get back and use this as opportunity to take advantage of some teams not being able to adapt as quick as a team like ours that's a little bit smaller. And so I'm excited. I've been working out really hard. Haley and I are working out right now. We're actually in the middle of it. So she's been my great training partner, keeping me motivated. I went and rode some, just got kind of knocked the rust off here and rode a go-kart a little bit yesterday. So trying to get my brain going, but there's really nothing you can do for your first laps on track at Darlington being lap one of the Southern 500, or I think that's still the name of it for this week.
So you mentioned that lap one. Darlington, for folks that don't know, Darlington's actually pretty tricky. And it's one of those tracks for you guys that takes a lot of mental capacity, takes a lot of physicality to race that racetrack. So when you lay down that first lap and you're going in turn one at Darlington, what's that going to be like?
Yeah, it's going to be unique. You know, I think probably a little more conservative than normally, because you just want to fill everything out and you're hoping that your car is, you know, all together in one piece and everything's working. Usually in practice, you get to fill it out a little bit, and if there's some different things that might be off, you and your team get to work on it. So you're probably going to be a little conservative lap one, but it's really hard to be conservative at 190 miles per hour. So Darlington is definitely the hardest track to adapt to. It's, you know, it's a track where you always talk about it's too tough to tame, and you race the racetrack. You don't race the other guys around you, and it's hard enough just to race the racetrack. So no practice, no qualifying. We're going to see some, you know, some talent rise to the top, I feel like, right away. And as the race goes on, guys are going to be able to work together with their teams and probably even out the field. But the beginning of the race is going to be super fun and exciting. Probably the whole race is going to be really exciting just with these unique circumstances. But I'm really excited for it myself.
And then looking ahead to the next week, we know that we have four Cup Series races in those 2 weeks. And one of those is the Coca-Cola 600. Now, Charlotte is our home track. We always love going to Charlotte. But what's the 600, one of the longest races of the season for that third race, going to be like for a driver?
Yeah, it's going to be wild, you know, just all these races back to back to back. And last year was the first time I ever really wore a heart rate monitor in a race car, was at the Coca-Cola 600. And it was a 5.5 hour race, and I averaged 155 heart rate, which is the same that I run when I'm running a 5K or anything else. I kind of tried to average and train at that heart rate. So it's pretty much like running a marathon for that whole race, heart rate wise, and strain on your body. So then to turn around and race 3 days later, it just puts a lot into your preparation, your hydration, and your recovery as a driver. And you're going to see the guys who've really put a lot into their physical fitness and mental rest. I think you're going to see them excel. And it's really fun. You know, I think a week is almost just enough time every week in a regular season for anyone to get recovered. I think when we start going back-to-back three-day breaks, you're going to see a lot of athletes. Yeah.
Yeah. It's going to be a lot of water, a lot of Gatorade, trying to get that hydration back up for you guys in those 2 or 3 days. It's going to be.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, so before I let you go back and work out with Haley, I have to ask you, because you put on your social too, you flew through a Rubik's Cube.
Yeah.
Do you know how hard that is, Steven?
Yeah.
I'm frustrated. How did you even learn how to do that?
So Haley and I.
Is that a trick that you picked up, or have you been doing that always?
Oh, it was a quarantine trick. Haley and I were like, let's try to figure this out. Like, let's go. Haley is so smart. Like, she can pick up things in a day that takes most people years. And so I'm like, let's go get Rubik's Cubes. Let's try to figure it out. And we were both, like, sitting in bed till midnight watching a YouTube video. So we didn't just figure it out on our own. So we watched YouTube videos. But watching YouTube videos, it took us 2 solid days to figure it out. But now it's locked into memory, and I can pretty much do it in within about 8 to 10 minutes every time. And she can, too. She figured it out way before me, but we've both been practicing quite a bit, and it's been fun. It's a fun thing for your brain to kind of stay fresh. And I've been kind of just doing it every once in a while, every day, to kind of make sure my brain's woken up, and maybe it'll help me in the race car. You never know.
Yeah. It might help with some hand eye coordination and some brain function in there, but I was watching it, and it's the video that you posted is obviously sped up. So it's not like your hands are moving that fast, but still it's pretty fast.
Yeah. Yeah. It's definitely fast. You kind of get a rhythm with it. There's a algorithm that you can find on YouTube. But also you're counting so much, and you kind of keep a rhythm with your hands, and you get faster and faster. And you watch those like competitive guys that can do it in 2 minutes, and you're like, I get it now, but I don't think I can move that fast.
Oh, absolutely not. All right, we'll get back to working out. Tell Haley and Oakley we said hello. We're excited to see you guys back on Sunday, and good luck at Darlington.